courage to do that, for that first book, to print that many, and to believe in your project that much?
I didn't start out believing. It's, and this is important. I tell people, I call it the tuna casserole test. If someone comes, if you invite someone to your house to eat, and they come over and you serve them tuna casserole, heavens forbid, and they eat and go, this is really good. Some people are like, wow, I'm going to go sell my tuna casserole. You know, tell my tuna casserole recipe. It's like, no, of course you're going to tell them it's good, right? Because they're in their house and you invited them. So if they tell you two or three times during dinner, wow, this is so good. And it's like, okay, but you don't do it yet. Okay, so then, hi, there's someone there.
Yeah, that's Lachelle, Skyping in from Vegas.
Hi, where are you?
I'm in Las Vegas.
Oh, nice. Is it warm there?
Yes, pretty warm, not too warm.
Good.
But not cold like where you are.
Yeah, a lot of snow.
Please continue.
Okay. So then, let's say they're leaving. They leave and they call and ask you for your recipe. The next day, it's like, okay, maybe I have something special here. But it's not the time to sell it yet. But so you give them the recipe. The next week, someone else calls, like, I just heard about this recipe. I've got to get it. That's when you start thinking about it. Okay, what happens with books? We fall in love with it. And it's kind of like the ugly child syndrome. It's just like every child is beautiful to its mother and father. So you have to realize that. It's like you start watching. So Christmas Box was a personal gift. It didn't mean I wasn't prepared to market. I was in marketing. And what happened is I saw the trend. Every time I'd put a few out, it would go. And after a while, it's like, this is viral. This will go. And so when the head of Simon & Schuster Worldwide took me to dinner in New York, he goes, how'd you know that it's going to do this? And I said, I was actually off by 60%. I thought we'd do better. He's like, you're the biggest book in the world. So you thought you'd do better. I said, well, based on the test tube. But my test tube, unfortunately, was in Utah. And so based on the test, I could see how we would grow. So I had the courage because I saw what was happening. People were asking for it. If you have to talk people into it, you don't have enough energy. So you have to remember that. The book is a product. It is something that they want to read. You're trying to. And this is something I always, my daughter's now a writer, and she's doing very well, but she learned something really important from me, and that is you love your readers and you give them everything. So one night we were working at 1 in the morning going through probably the book was going in. We still did another 3,000 edits on a book that was finished. And she goes, do you think your readers have any idea how hard you work on this? And I said, consciously, no, but subconsciously, every time they walk into a bookstore, they have 250,000 other books to choose from, and they know that there's something in there. So it's got to be that quality, and it has to be you, okay? And that, in fact, this is a segue to a really good story. The most read thing is, what do you think the most read thing I have is? I've written. Any idea?
Five Lessons a Millionaire Taught Me.
Not you, Brady. No, it's How I Saved My Marriage. The last I checked, it had more than 150 million readers. It's everywhere. I'm getting letters from Pakistan. It's bizarre. I was in Kentucky, and a marriage counselor says he hands it out to everyone when they walk in. My wife hates that a lot. And I remember when she called me. I was up with my dad, and she chased me, and she goes, my mom just called. They're talking about your stupid blog on Channel 4. I was on the phone with Huffington Post, who wanted to put in 7 more languages. And she goes, you got to stop at this. Honey, you don't stop a blog. Once it's on the internet, it's totally beyond my control. There's 80, I can look on my Google Analytics. There's 86,000 people reading it right now. It's like, I can't stop anything. And finally, we got to our 20th fight. I mean, like, that night we went to dinner, and seriously, this couple got up next to us, and they said, we're here because of you. That blog saved our marriage. And I go, tell her. And so it's finally we got in this big fight. I said, did I say anything that wasn't true? And she said, that's the problem. It's all true. And has anyone read that blog? So, and the thing is, she had heard me give this talk in public many times. It never occurred to me she would be upset. Right? I mean, she's heard it. I've been there. I didn't even think about it because she's been a willing participant in this. So I'm really not that thoughtless. So anyway, she said something that's really profound. I want you to consider this. She said, you tell too much. And I said, no, I can't tell too much. I go, yeah, I'm completely honest. I bleed in every single book. My last book, The Noel Diary, people absolutely love it. It's doing crazy. I have 2 movie offers, and it's like, it is the most real thing I've ever written. And there's a scene, that, has anyone read it? Thank you. You know, in the beginning, when they walk out, she beats them and then walks out with a suitcase, packs his suitcase with his little boy, and walks out the side of the street and goes, go find a home? That's me. I sat by the side of a road holding a suitcase as an 11-year-old boy, not knowing where I was supposed to live. Mm-hmm. And when you bleed that much, it's like people immediately respond to it. And so what I said to Carrie, I said, no, I have to be honest. I have to be honest. They, you can see right through it. You know it's much writing a book to try to be rich. You're writing a book for the wrong reason. It's like, the only thing I know how to do is tell my story. And if I don't do that, I just have to stop writing. And God gave me a gift to write. I go, that's one thing. I go, I give you everything. You know, I always, whatever you want, I pretty much do. I go, I don't compromise here. I go, this is one place I would leave you alone. If you're saying I can't write, then I would be offended. I'd be picking between you and God, and you and my whole purpose of life. And the fact that you would put me in that position, I would leave you. This is a woman I love more than anyone in the world. I've been married 36 years. And she stopped about it for a moment. She goes, you're right. Here's her. My family hid everything. My family lived, her family lived a big life. They had a huge dysfunction and they would never talk. I was been married 36 years, dated 12 years, never saw her parents hold hands or kiss. It's like, that's not okay. So when you're writing, it is so important to be honest. To put it out there, because anyone can read right through it. Does that make sense? Okay. So it just make it real. That voice, and that's the problem some of you have. You don't know how cool you are. I mean, you know, it's true. It's especially because we're all broken, and we're all sinners, and we're all. And the thing is, that's what makes you valuable. You start when people start sharing that. You know, I come in and talk about. I was doing my 5 lessons thing on a famous site online. I said, I was telling the 6 disclosures, and I said, the 7th thing, I said, I should probably tell you I have Tourette syndrome. If you see me, like, bleep, you know, I'm not flirting with you. It's like, I have Tourette syndrome. And, boy, immediately people respond to that. You know, I wrote the first blog I wrote that went viral, I put it out, but the next morning it came back, had 75,000 likes on Facebook. And what it was is, a woman sent me a letter saying, I was speaking in a church about love, about God's love for us and grace. And she wrote a letter saying, I have no place in the church because I'm such a sinful man. And she said, I know you're sinful because you were trying to hide it, but your face kept twitching. And I wrote back, I said, no doubt I'm a sinful man. But that's not why my face was twitching. I have Tourette syndrome. And then I wrote, I said, you know what was sad? I said, when I was little, I would have believed you. I went to church and I wanted to touch a man. They said a church leader was coming up. Maybe if I shook his hand, my Tourette's would go away if I had enough faith. I was 9 years old. It didn't go away, so I held it on myself. My mother told me to stop twitching, and I couldn't. So I felt guilt. And I said, I see little boys. There's little boys and girls who want to commit suicide because of the Tourette's. I go, you know what? You can't touch me. Whatever you say, I go, because there are tens of thousands and hundreds of thousands of us with brokenness and neurological disorders. But I've danced in the White House, honey. I've been to 22 countries. I've met with presidents and rock stars. I've helped more than 100,000 abused children. You can't touch me. I said, that little boy is safe inside of me. But I am angry for those other little boys that you might affect, and those other little girls. And I go, maybe this will open up your eyes, or better yet, your heart, and know this, the truest disability is the inability to love others that are different than you. And that was a letter. I actually wrote that letter for a mother who had come to a book signing with her 16-year-old son who clearly had Tourette's. He was ticking like crazy. And I looked down, I assumed he was there because it was Michael Bay, I assumed he was there because he had Tourette's. I go, how old were you when your Tourette's manifested? And she said, he doesn't have Tourette's. Bull crap. We did that. We don't want to label him. You know, oh, ma'am, believe me, that's already done. Yeah. The day I found out I had Tourette's was the best day of my life. I wept, but it's like, okay, I'm not a bad person. I'm not disobedient. I'm not, I have a neurological disorder, and it's not because I'm bad. And that was a great day. And so I wrote that letter actually for one person. Next morning, 75, and I thought, I should probably share this, 75,000 likes the next morning. I just kept going. Okay, it was vulnerable, it was real. I mean, you like me more now that I told you that, right? I mean, seriously, you do. Yeah, Alex.
So that leads into a question I wanted to ask. To bleed onto the page like that takes an incredible amount of vulnerability, but vulnerability without the self-esteem and the like knowledge that I can handle it, I can allow the world to see this side of me and be safe. How do you know you've reached that point where you can be that vulnerable and still feel safe having the entire world see it?
Yeah, that's a good point. This is a hard thing. I remember when I wrote my second book, Timepiece, the critics were horrible. My agent called me at 6 in the morning. She's in New York. She said, have you seen USA Today? I said, no. She goes, don't. It's the worst review I've ever seen. They basically were trying to destroy you. And I got so much hate. And what they do is, like, you have this huge success, you watch it. If you win a Pulitzer Prize, they try to kill you the next book. Mm-hmm. So I had this massive success. It usually comes from newspapers because they're writers. Newspaper, I mean, they're writers too, and they're not making what you're making. So they're nasty, mm-hmm. and they're jealous. And so I remember one time just struggling, and I struggled, and finally the head of Simon Schuster said to me, she goes, you've got to get thicker skin. She goes, yeah, you read a few reviews. There's a few 100,000 people who disagree, and they buy books. And it took a while. And so in my case, the problem is I'm a highly sensitive individual. That's the good news and the bad news. That's why I'm able to write the way I write, because I'm highly sensitive. But it also hurts. So the other day, someone wrote something really nasty about Michael Vay, and she just wrote this really mean letter. Just like, this is kind of like, and she taught disabled students of all people, who, for Michael Vay, this is a book that sold 3 million copies. I don't really give a damn about some woman in Lehigh said that she had done it. It's like, it's won 14 awards. You know, it's been picked the best book of the state in 7 states. It's like, you know, I don't care what you think. But part of me still does. So what I did, I wrote her back a letter. I said, that was a really mean letter. And I go, I care about this. And then I get a letter the next day. She goes, I am really sorry. You're a real person. That was really rude. That was internet bullying. She goes, I am as bad as anyone. And it was really nice. You know, it come back. So I mean, as she wrote back, it's like, yeah, I'm a real person. So how do you know? You have to not care. Okay, because you're gonna be hated no matter what you do. Okay, you will. There's always someone who thinks they're better, smarter, and there's always a million. I mean, you would be amazed at how many letters I got of people telling me, when I have the number one book in the world, how I should have written it. And they want to be writers. Well, if you had done this, and it's like, just go to hell. I go, and what I used to say is, well, write your own book.
Yeah.
Go ahead, do it.
Yeah.
It's like, really?
Give me the arena.
Yeah, go do it. Because there's no one, when I see a 1-star review on Amazon, the best-selling books, I think these guys are idiots. Because no one has a bestseller who's writing a 1-star book. No one. Mm-hmm. Because they're competing. When I get up in the morning, I have to compete with Stephen King and John Grisham. I mean, I see my name surrounded by that. Comes out, it's like, well, I'm two above Mary Higgins Clark, you know? It's just like, that's who I compete with in the morning. Like, where are you? Mm-hmm. You know? So, but you just have to blow it off. And you have to do it because you care. And the first time that happened to me, I got this really nasty letter in Christmas box. And I read it, it hurt. I mean, it was brand new. And it's like, everything I read was hurtful. I would hate to look at my email because I knew there'd be hate mail. Can you believe that? It's like, and then there's a letter from a woman who said, I have suffered from the death of my daughter for the last 12 years. I finally found some peace because of your book. I can't thank you enough. And you looked at it, and it's like, well, who did I write this for? Okay, so that's the thing. Maybe it takes some time. It took me years to kind of get used to it. It took me a lot of success. Because you do get that point. I mean, the best writers have always been attacked. The most popular writers have always been attacked. I'm sorry, time for yes.
I was gonna say I understand how to be vulnerable on the page and online. I mean, like you said, I can't live any other way. And I understand that I have a message that will affect a lot of people that they need in order to heal. But my question is, you know, how to take all that and actually get it to them, because like delivery is a huge problem for me, like connecting to the audience, finding them, instead of just having all these gems and keeping them remain in obscurity. That's been my main struggle for the past.
Okay, let me give you some advice. This is, first of all, that is all a book is delivery. So that's if you can't do that, you can't write. But let me give you an idea how to write. After I wrote my first book, they gave me a $4.2 million advance. And with the expectation that I actually knew how to write. Yeah, I wrote it. And so all of a sudden I have this expectation and this money to write a bestseller. And boy, I just froze up. And after 6 months, I'm completely frozen. And they're getting really nervous. They put all this money down. It's like, well, can we help you? Can we? It's just like getting ghostwriter, whatever we need. And I thought, why is this not coming? And I went out walking. That's what I do. That's how I break my writer's block. Thoreau said there's a connection between our legs and our brains, and I believe. So I'm out writing, and all of a sudden I had the greatest epiphany of my career. I have no idea how to write a bestseller. This was perhaps the best moment and the most important moment of my development as a writer. Because as soon as I realized that, I thought, I have no idea. What is your name?
Maria.
It's like, I don't know what Maria likes. No, I don't know a thing about Maria. She has lovely eyes. But I don't know a thing. I don't know how she's responding or if she eats my books. I can't write something that's gonna reach her heart. All I know is my heart. When I wrote The Christmas Box, it was profoundly personal because I was madly in love with two little girls, Jenna and Allison, and Britt's wife. Britt's my son-in-law. She wasn't born yet. I was, as a father, I was head over heels in love with these two little girls, and I didn't want to have children. So the fact that I had this great epiphany in my life, I still smile and think about it. It was the best thing that ever happened to me, and I wanted to share that. So I wrote it for them. When they're older, I thought they'll read my book. It was so personal about my deepest feelings. So then all of a sudden, it's like, oh, we're going to make you famous. You're famous. Let's do this. And it's like, so when I realized I had no idea, I just wrote the book I wanted to, fully expecting failure. Okay. It was a huge result. And so, in fact, ironically, the books I think are going to fail, like my last one, I thought Noel Diary, is like, this one is going to die. It has the highest Amazon reviews of any of my books. People absolutely love it. I don't know until the book goes out, but it was so personal. So write for yourself. That's all you know how to do. Michael Bay was just fun. It was the little boy I wanted to be. He has Tourette syndrome. I want him to get the cheerleader. And so I mean Taylor and the cheerleader. She's a real person. She's named Lynn Tonneson. She actually came to my book signing in Los Angeles. She was there. It's like he said I was going to be a character. I emailed her. It's like, you didn't tell me it's going to be like a really big, famous character. It's like, yeah, you were the cheerleader that I was afraid to talk to. You know? So I wrote it. When I wrote it, it was fun. This is joyful. So the Walk series, has anyone read the Walk series? That book to this day, it's what? 8 years old, still sells between 500 and 700 copies a week. It doesn't go away. It just keeps selling and selling. It sold millions of copies. And that was really personal. And I thought, I asked myself a question. If you took away everything I have, you took away Carrie, you took away my kids, you took away my home, you took away my career, and then kicked me out of my home, what would I live for? Why would I keep living? And I thought, that's a deep question. That's worth exploring. And that's why I did in The Walk. So I asked that question. And it became something that did really well because people related to it. Yes, you had a question.
You kind of already answered it, because I was wondering what was the inspiration for your very first book, and what made you decide where you, how did you become an author? Like, is it just like you just had to just start writing, and you just kept writing and then just pushed it out to publishers, or what is your beginning?
You know, well, I'm self-published.
The most successful self-pub author of all time.
Still so there's kind of like four kinds of authors I decided. You have the lawyers, that's like Scott Turow and Baldacci and Grisham, right? Then you have like the single mothers who got dumped and are trying to survive, like Mary Higgins Clark and Ann Rule. Then you have the literary, you know, like Cole Melton and the people that went jumps around. And then you have the advertisers, like James Patterson and me. And if you notice what we do, we write really short chapters because we're used to writing 30 to 60 second commercials, and they're always really compelling. Dan Brown writes like an advertiser. I was writing radio and TV commercials, and it was the best training. And you've heard about like the 10,000 hours you need to put in. Well, writing commercials was fantastic because no one wants to see my stuff. So I have to catch you immediately and bring you in, right? If you see a commercial, if you don't like it in the first 3 seconds, you're already gone. You turned out. And so as it's great, you know, that's great practice, write commercials. So that's the kind of writer I was. So the other thing is because I have, with my Tourette's, I have attention deficit, I know everyone. But I was such a poor reader because I had so much trouble focusing on books that I probably shouldn't have been able to become a writer, but it actually helped me because I get bored so fast, my books have to move really quick. So I just throw everything away that slows the book down.
Sorry.
This reminds me, you remember The Dark Knight? When he goes, and this guy on the screen, he's a squealer. Best movie ever. Yeah.
Speaking of inspiration, I don't know if you've read Elizabeth Gilbert's book, Big Magic, or seen her TED Talk that you watched yesterday, but she talks about inspiration being this ethereal thing that comes and offers you this gift, and you have to be willing to accept the gift or risk it flying away and leaving. What's your experience with inspiration? Is it something similar? You have to sort of grasp it when it's there, or
oh, yeah.
Can you harness it at will?
No, I can't. Stephen King. In his book on writing, it's a good book. If you haven't read that, it's a good book. And the fact they spend so much time talking about adverbs is awesome. But he says, he goes. Someone said, "Where did you come up with the ideas for your book?" And he goes, "I don't. Just there," because I'm more like an archaeologist uncovering the bones. And the reporter said, "I don't believe you." And he said, "That's okay, as long as you believe that I do that." And when I read that, I thought, "That's exactly right." I always feel like the book's there, and the only time I get blocked is when I'm going the wrong direction. Like, nope, you went astray. Stop, roadblock. And so then I go walking, and it comes back. So yeah, I believe in that inspiration, and I believe in paying the muses. Isn't that the whole point of Calliope? She's a muse.
Muse of epic poetry.
So, I do believe in inspiration. You know, there are times when it just shuts off. My son went through some really severe things 2 years ago, and finally, I just wrote my publisher. It's like, I have a book due. I said, I can't write it. I stare at the screen. I don't know if my son will be alive anymore. I go, it's all I can do to get out of bed and protect my wife. And it was like, we went through hell. And, during that time, I just said, I go think of it this way. If I was a football player, I mean, I'm on that level, right? It's like I'm an NFL football player. I just got injured. Okay, I just pulled a hamstring. I go, I'm off. You got to bench me. And they were awesome. Jonathan Cart, President of Syracuse, Rebecca, I am so sorry, Rick. Take your time. Do it next year, 5 years. I don't care. Take care of yourself. And so, if you're in the wrong place, it doesn't come. And you have to be grateful. There's not a single book that at the end I haven't realized that I didn't write this book, that it was something I didn't think would be. And so the other thing is that time, ideas have a really short shelf life, so you've got to grab them. I've had ideas that you've all probably had this, like, that is such a good idea, I will remember it in the morning. It's gone, isn't it? In fact, you remember that there was something there, but you can't even remember the content, you can't even remember what it was about. I mean, it could be like a new way to get to work. You're just like, oh my gosh, what was that? So one time I'm in the shower, and I'm thinking about, this is my book, Timepiece, and I'm thinking about what a parent goes through thinking about their children growing up, and how you have this, like right now I have a granddaughter, and my grandson at this age, they're just adorable. It's like, it's not gonna last forever, it is so fleeting. And he makes a comment, I make a comment. It's like, the reason sunsets in childhood are so beautiful is because they're both fleeting. And so, but I'm in the shower and I'm thinking, wow, if only I could just stop this time. If I could freeze it, and all of a sudden this line comes to me, but in this you err, to hold the note is to spoil the song. Mm. And I thought, damn, that is beautiful. I jumped out of there, buck naked, nothing to write with but my wife's lipstick. I write this down because that was worth getting out and writing in lipstick. It was that good. And so if you don't honor those things, I think the muses stop giving them to you. You get it, you honor it, and you say thank you, and you burn sacrifices or whatever, but it's like, but you be grateful for it.
Yes. On that same note, have you ever received one of those inspiring moments? You write it down, put it in a notebook, and then you put it down because you have to go to sleep, or you have to do your week's worth of work for your family. You pull it back up, it's not there. The words are there, but the feelings that were evoked, the time that you got it, it's like, I can't write this. Yeah. This is not even me. I don't even know
what
that
is. Yeah, but you have to realize that as humans, we're undulating, right? So there's times you're really close, sometimes it's not going to. And your readers are the same way. A reader who thinks it's the best book ever and at the wrong time will think it's an awful, boring book. And so that's this undulation that happens. What you do is that you just let it even out because it may not feel right then, but you just leave it. And just let it kind of mellow, and you come back and look at it, and it's like it's still not good then. You throw it out.
Good. Okay, I'm not good.
The other thing, let me give you an advice, something I do. Because my books have to move so fast, and I hate the term, I think it's really profane, killing babies, they don't want to return. But you're taking things that are really important to you, right? And because the book must move at all costs. So there are times I go through and think, like that line I just go to. I told you, this I err, to spoil the, you know, to hold the notes, to spoil the song. But it slowed the book down. So what do I do with it? What I would do is after I go through the book, I pull out everything that slows the book down, and I put it in the morgue. Okay? So I always keep, every book has a morgue. And I put it in there. What happens, that's why I have diary entries in my books. So the books move, but you always stop at the head of the chapter anyway, right? So I put them at the chapter so it doesn't break up the book. So I go back to the end and think, oh yeah, that's good, that's good. So you can do that with it. Come back and say, oh yeah, I like that part. This is where it really fits. And you're not, I don't know anyone except for Dickens that got books sequentially. So your books are kind of all around the place. So just keep your notes and watch it because the book may go down a hall and turn a corner that you didn't expect. It's like, oh, that piece of the puzzle fits right there. I didn't know at the time because I didn't have the surrounding pieces. Does that make sense?
Yes, it does. Because I've written, I've got like 10 parts.
Oh yeah, that happens. But just,
I don't know how to pull it together.
Yeah, just hold it. Just put it together. Just throw it on there. Just ugly. Don't edit it. Just don't do anything. Just throw it on the morgue. And as you're going through, and just keep it spare. Just make sure the story's moving. Then you can come back to it.
Okay.
Yes.
Oh. Okay. You and me, we did advertising. I did 35 years of my life doing advertising.
Awesome.
Yeah. Big part in Brazil and then moved to here. My problem is, telling stories became kind of, because the craft, you know, became that mania that make things shorter. The shorter the better, because you have 3 seconds to call the attention of the guy or he will throw your idea or your thing on the ground. And when I write something, people say, come on, it's too short. Do you have this kind of problem about this? Oh, I spoiled the moment because I put things too short.
No, you didn't spoil it. That's fantastic. You want to leave when they still want you. So every book I write, I get the same thing. I wish it were longer. Good. Because if someone says, man, it was too long, it's like, you lost it. Maybe the book sucked. And so, no, if they're telling you that your book's too short, that is a great compliment. If they're telling you they want more. This was so good, I wanted more. And so just make sure it's long enough. Look at it. I mean, don't write a novella if you're trying to write a novel. But that's a real compliment. Does that make sense? Yes?
How do you deal with it emotionally when you go back and you read your stuff, you thought it was good, it was going on point, and you realize it's just crap? How do you how do you kind of buck up and say, I need to cut this? Yeah, it is killing your darlings, you know, but sometimes you write well, and sometimes you're having a bad day, you're writing, you know, you put a 1,000 words on the page and it's just awful.
Yeah, everything I write is crap. My daughter said something. She goes, I love it because I'm watching my daughter. Jen has a hard thing because people say, wow, because your dad's Richard Paul Evans. And it's like, well, yeah, she got to work by my side for 8 years and travel with me for 20 years and be at every book sign. And it's like, books are her life far more than they ever were mine. She actually has a degree in writing, which I don't have. And so it's tough because people treat her, you know, and other writers, well, you just have that. It's like, no, she's actually a good writer. And her last book spent 8 weeks on the New York Times bestseller list. It's out in 15 countries. It's selling 1,000 copies a week. It's a year old. I mean, damn, it was voted as one of the best by the American Library Association, one of the 10 best books of the year. But she still has this thing, like, oh, because you're, even though my name's not anywhere on it. But it's fun watching her develop as a writer. And what she's learned is that work ethic, and she's learned that it's like it's not easy and that everything you write is crap. And she goes, so she every now and then, if you go to Jenna, if you just look at my daughter, she writes things that are really fun. But she wrote, why do the first three drafts have to be steaming piles of crap? Why can't I just jump over that part? I go, because that's pretty much what it is. But my book right now, my agent called me. She goes, do you like it? I go, no, I hate it. She goes, oh, shoot. I don't like my books the last few weeks. Okay, I polish. I look at my books. I'm almost like a sculptor looks with marble. You polish. And all of a sudden, it starts getting good. But it takes a hell of a lot. Okay, so just because it's crap doesn't mean it's not moving. Doesn't mean it's not smart. It just means you need to polish it up. It's rough on the edges, or you've got a thing you need to chop off there. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I self-published, and by the time I got done, I hated my book. And I'm like, I can't change it. I have to go with it. And it was kind of like postpartum depression, I guess. It's like, here's this beautiful thing I created. Oh, and it's ugly.
But you know what? You also, Elton John said he never listened to his music after he recorded it. I mean, you've read the book 60 times. I don't know.
Yeah.
I can't watch anything 60 times and still like it. Except for, like, Spinal Tap. Or you know what I mean? It's like,
yeah.
You can't. So just, you just have to trust in that. But in your heart, you'll know if it's good. You'll know if it's right. The thing is, like, you either hear the music or you don't. And when I was in advertising, my mentor said to me, he goes, You know you're talented when you have an opinion. Okay. For instance, Glenn Beck gave me a book and he goes, no one wants this. Someone had ghostwritten it. And he goes, my publisher doesn't like it. And I read it. What do you think? You missed a lot of opportunities. It could be a lot better. And he goes, well, what would you change? And finally said, do you want me to just rewrite it? And he goes, are you kidding me? Seriously? So I rewrote the book. And I just it took me about 4 days. Because it was all there, it was easy. I just went through and just made it good, and it was like, oh yeah, this is wrong. But it was, in respect to the ghostwriter, it's always easier to go in after it's done, because then you can see it. Anyone can be a critic, and so I went in there and fixed it, and it went off and sold 1.5 million copies. I mean, it was number one bestseller. It did really well, but it was easy to look at it because I had an opinion. And it's like, well, you could have made it like it's a Christmas story. It's his book, The Christmas Sweater. And that was like a big secret till he said it on TV, and you know, Richard actually rewrote it. But up to that point, he just kept it. He asked me what he owed, which probably would have been like $250,000. And I said, you know what? My wife's mad because I blew off our weekend. Why don't you send her some chocolates? Mm-hmm. So that's what I did. That's what I did. I did it for a box of chocolates. And okay.
All right. I think we've got time for one more question.
Mine is the opposite of what's been going on. What if you really like your book and your story, but others hate it? I think it's good, but then they think it's crap.
Wow. Well, think of it as food. You know, if you cook and you really like it and no one wants to eat it, you're just going to eat a lot of your own food. That's what you have to figure out. It may be that you're just giving it to the wrong people.
We actually, we have a whole session on that, you guys.
Oh, there you go.
On Sunday, yeah. It's called the purpose, what's it called?
Purpose pentagram.
Purpose pentagram? Like, why are you writing? Who's your audience? Are you writing it personal? Are you writing it for, Michael can rattle these off, I can't. For profit, for praise?
Posterity.
Posterity, or to provide? And you gotta know who your audience is, and maybe it's
just. Oh, I like that.
Yeah. Yeah, because there are different things you do depending on what that pathway is, what you're interested in. And if you're interested in for praise and for profit, you gotta be interested in what's your audience. Like, know your genre. Know what your audience is looking for. Study stories. Read books that are in your genre. See what they did right. And then, of course, the rest of the conference will talk about how to do that. So, anyway.
Yeah, one last thing. I noticed that in writing, a lot of people, have you ever watched kids play soccer?
Yeah.
Okay, they don't keep their positions. They go in a mob and they follow the ball. And it's like, all of a sudden the ball will pop out, and then the mob goes over there and they'll kick each other and kick everyone and kind of stuff. And what real players like stay, keep their position. That's really important because what happens after the Christmas box, the New York Times wrote an article that says, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas box. There are 300 imitations. I would walk in stores and it's like, maybe you use the same type. My wife goes, oh, there's your book. It's like, the Christmas box. It's just like, there are all these imitations. Same with Twilight, same with Bridges of Madison County. They copy it. The problem is, it's already been done. You know, it's like, wow, I'm gonna write a vampire story. Sorry, I'm gonna be way too old. Okay, the message there is keep your position. I knew a woman who liked to write Amish love stories, and of all people, an Amish love story. All of a sudden became this huge genre. My agent called me, she goes, you'll never believe what genre is killing it. I go, are they like Amish love stories? She goes, how do you know that? I have a friend who writes them, and she's doing really well. So write what's true to you. Again, it comes back to your voice and being true. My daughter Jenna had a horrible experience, her second book. That's been like, it's hard having two little kids and ones who are really rambunctious. And they sent the book back, the editor, and they rewrote the end of it. She called me yesterday, just tears and angry. And my agent called them, told them to F off. We had the same agent, so Lori called them and just blew their heads off, so now they're terrified of it. It's like, she goes, they made it vanilla. I said, I've never met an editor that can actually write. I had one of the best editors in the world, literally, Sidney Meier, vice president of Simon Schuster, the second largest publisher in the world. And she would take something and rewrite it, and it would be awful. But I could get what she was trying to say, why it wasn't working. I listened to coaches. I listened to my editors. And that is one thing that's important. What's your name?
Andrew.
So that is one piece of advice I do have. Listen to them. And have an expert say, well, yeah, this is why. You may like that, but other people won't because of this. And listen to them. So, and you'll get better. You don't sell your soul out. And there are times when I just say, no, you're wrong. So, anyway, well, this is fun. Good luck on your book.